Hey everybody, so I am back today and I'm doing a bit of a heresy hump day, just chat like I did last time. I don't know that it's going to be as inspired this time because I don't have a whole lot of dedicated topics to talk about, so I'm just going to see how it goes. I might not upload this if it ends up being long bouts of silence without anything to say. I usually don't have that problem. For those of you that have watched my Q&As or granted, I've had topics and questions to talk about there. Sadly, I can actually just talk on and on, and just kind of, I'm not sure what that really says about me, but, you know, I'm not sure if that's a good thing, that I just always have something to say. But yeah, we'll see. So, I have a couple things that I was going to sort of mention for updates. This week, what I've been doing is just working on my goblins, as I said I would. And what I decided, even though I'm not done with the base painting on the actual miniatures, what I decided to get these guys starting to looking like they're moving forward is I thought I would actually just get the first coat of paint on the bases. Because I find that the plaster, unfinished plastic sort of look that they're standing on really gives me this psychological impression that they're really far from being done. And so I find even the difference between, I'm ready to like put this in my mouth so I can't speak. I find the difference between these two guys, which I'm holding by the base, which defeats the whole purpose of everything I'm trying to demonstrate here. But I find the difference between these two guys, one with having the base done and one not, just looks so different. Just like, even though it's not. From like my painting psychology of where I'm at with these guys. So I'm getting the first thing of paint on here. It's funny, since I got these stands that I was showing off last week, the paint stands, I found all these extras, because when I have certain paints, which Game Color Earth is one that I use for most of my basing, a lot of my basing these days, for most games, particularly historicals, but I'm using it for the fantasy, too. I end up picking up bottles, and whenever I pick up an extra, I just find a spot for it, and I'm like, oh, I'll just leave it there, you know, for when I run out. And then when I go through all my paints, because I've got these stands, I find I have, like, all these extra bottles that I end up picking up over time that I didn't even realize. Extras upon extras upon extras. I suppose that's a good thing, though, with this one, because I just go through so much of it. It won't actually dry out or go to waste. So, yeah, like, I'm really looking forward to playing some Age of Sigmar. Eventually, I would like to try some of the old Warhammer Fantasy as well. I don't know how long it's been since I did the videos when AOS was coming out, and I guess AOS has been out for, has it been 2 years? Or has it been just a year and a half? I don't really remember. But I was really just determined to just play the original Fantasy game, because I never had. And then, you know, it ended. But I'm thinking I'm still going to try that, or Ninth Age and some of that stuff at one point, once I build these guys up a bit. But I am looking forward to being able to jump in, because I know folks that play Age of Sigmar, just to try it out. It's interesting. I think it's one of those, I mean, a lot of people have moved on from the controversy of it, but it's one of those things that even to this day, I mean, people are just like completely on board with it, or they completely are old fantasy players and are still quite mad at it, at its existence. And part of that, in all fairness, isn't just its existence, but it's the fact that it's like a bit of a symbol of the lack of their other game that is no longer supported. It's interesting. I haven't played the game, so I don't really, I'm not speaking from experience here, but having watched it and listened to people, the impression I get is because it was released with such a bare minimum amount of rules, and it was just such a difference from the original, like, which actually had a fairly robust rule system. I think what people found when they played it is that there was a certain level of challenge and tactic or skill, like, in the game, despite the fact that the rules were very simple. But, like I said, people tend to be just on board with that or not. I was thinking yesterday, I love the fact that I'm playing goblins. I have, like, absolutely no regrets that I've actually chosen goblins. And I was thinking yesterday, I was looking at these banners, and I was thinking, what am I going to do about these banners? Like, am I going to try to print something, or am I going to try to paint something myself? What are they going to be? And I was trying to think about the personality, because although I do want to incorporate orcs at one point and ally some orcs with these guys, my core army I want to be goblins. And the rule, which I think is just very cool, and you look, I believe it's in the General's Handbook, the rule for the goblin war boss is that because, like, I think goblins are sort of insecure. In a lot of ways, because of their size and you know, the fact that they actually have to have huge numbers and things. And so that's one of the things I kind of like about them. I kind of find it funny and just a very cool, fluffy sort of feel to having the army. And the war boss, you know, is meant to be, like, the biggest and the baddest of the insecure bunch, right? And the rules have it such that if the war boss actually kills another hero or another war boss, that it just boosts the entire army tremendously. Like, because when they see that, they're like, see, we are, like, the biggest and the baddest, you know? And I just think that that's so funny and so cool. And just, like, whether it be orcs or goblins, their intentions, you know, for what they're in this for, like, I think the fluff of my army, which probably fits with goblins, is that, like, they're really in this for the money, you know? Like, they're in this to pillage, and it's all about, for these guys, it's all about success and getting the money and stuff. And so I was thinking about what the symbol should be on the banner. Now, I am going to use Wolf Riders, and I did mention that I wanted to do generic goblins because of the kind of list, or because of the my liking of Lord of the Rings and stuff, which is very non-AOS. I know with AOS, they're basically trying to move away from generic fantasy to have for GW to have their own niche. And Night Goblins actually fit that, because I think Night Goblins, to a big degree, are a GW creation, to my knowledge. I could be wrong about that, but I've never seen them before GW. And so, in a lot of ways, the Night Goblins are, like, GW's goblins. But these generic goblins that I have, you know, I like generic fantasy and Lord of the Rings and all that stuff, and that's kind of one of the things I like. And so, I was thinking about incorporating something that either had a glowing treasure chest, like, on the banner, you know, because that's kind of what they're all about, and the wolf sort of symbol. So one or the other, or both in combination, which I kind of like the idea of both in combination. Now, I'm going to be freehanding these I guess I only have one banner that I chose right now that actually would have this on there. The others are just skulls and tassels, but so it would only be one banner for the moment, because I have three units, and I chose just one that actually has, like, a surface to actually have a symbol on. I'm going to be painting it up, so I don't think I'm, like, the best when it comes to freehand, but I'm sure I can figure something out. But yeah, I think that's going to be what I go for. Now, I already have some orcs, some black orcs and stuff to add as allies and stuff at one point. And I definitely think I'll be, I guess in AOS they're called Iron Jaws. I guess I'll be adding Iron Jaws at one point. So I have some options, but what I'd really like to be the main allies for these guys are giants. The reason being is I like the dichotomy of, like, the littlest guys and the biggest guys together. And in some ways, I like the idea of having a goblin war boss with giants that have actually determined to follow him. Can you imagine how good that would make him feel? Now, I've not placed an order with Forge World in an extremely long time. I'm trying to remember. It's been many years. But I really like the Bone Crusher Giant model. it's gigantic. I think having it like on the side of a goblin army would just be amazing, or amidst the goblins. So I'm thinking I might, depending on how much I like AOS, that might be what I get. And I might even just add some regular GW giants to the mix too at one point. I think that's what I want, is a primarily goblin army, and then some giants that have allied with them. Yeah. So I'm kind of having fun with this again, as you can probably tell. I'm kind of really interested to try it out. I was always intrigued by fantasy, despite being into the 40K, because of my D&D background. I've always been interested in it, so it's fun. Getting through the first 60 goblins has not been the smoothest thing. Like, I've not been as dedicated as I should be. I'm hoping that once I have the first 60 and I get the paint scheme to the way I want it and figure it out, that everything else will be a little bit easier. And just from it, just getting down and getting it done kind of perspective. I think it was Tristan that was talking about how he just did like 300. And I'm sitting here with 60 and I'm like having trouble staying on it and not moving on other things. And he just did like 300. Now, I'm not sure if Tristan does commissions or if it was for a friend. I think he may have said at one point that he does some commission work. That's something that I've never had an interest in trying, because I can barely get the stuff that I want to get done. And a big part of the inspiration for me is just getting my own stuff done for games and stuff. So I've never tried commission work. I mean, if I get discouraged just because of like a large number of models or something, imagine if it was something that I didn't even want to paint, or if it wasn't for me, I'd be like done. Although, maybe it's just because of the way I think about it, and maybe I would need to just change the way I thought about it or something. But I don't know. So, moving on from the AOS, there were a couple things I wanted to mention today. Just one was in relation to one of my last updates and just feedback that I'd gotten. I guess I'll start with that. Those little houses that I mentioned in that other video, I appreciate the feedback that I got on those. Part of it is because I play multiple areas of historical wargaming, and I don't really consider myself like a very good history buff, you know, among multiple areas. It's always sort of a learning thing for me, and depending on the area, like French Indian Wars, I've had an interest in, and so for me, that I actually know some of the history aspect, and it's not a foreign thing for me to learn. I still had people tell me what a brace of pistols is. Like, I didn't know what that was. Like, I remember that on a video. That was really helpful. But the houses in Saga, Dark Ages, although I've seen what folks have offered, like from Source of Precision or Foreground, and I recognize some of those features, which in some cases they're lack of features, you know, in the Dark Ages. It didn't really sink in when I was trying to think about how I could use these and stuff. And so I appreciate, I had, I think it was Osterwolf was one. I had a number of people talk about the houses and how, like, you know, you really wouldn't want a chimney on there, and, you know, that would need to go if you're planning on using it. A couple of folks did mention, you know, you can use it, maybe Robert Chisholm, you could use it for your French Indian War stuff. I apologize if I get people wrong, because I get a lot of good comments, you know, among the same sort of conversations, and sometimes they do blend in, together after a while to me. But the thought on what I'm going to do with them, you know, I don't want to use them for my black powder gaming, even though they might be easier the way they are now to be used for that. I don't think they'll match up with my dedicated stuff I have for that period. And I also have so much. It's just not needed. And so really the idea to use these buildings for me would have been cool just to use them for something that I actually need some terrain for. And the two areas that I was thinking about were Saga in the Dark Ages and Malifaux, which is more of a weird Western Victorian mishmash, because like it's a bit of a fantasy game, and so you can use lots of different stuff. Now, I thought, as they are now, those buildings, I could actually very easily use them for Malifaux, because they have a nice storybook look to them. But I'm still a bit far away from playing Malifaux, and I'm only really limping into that game with the crew. I'm not actually even sure that I'll play it much after trying it. Like, I like the models. I just wanted to try it out, and I just don't know even whether I like it yet. So I really do want to use them for Dark Ages. So I decided, I think, that I'm just going to regress the conversion backwards. And what I'll do, I am going to do some sort of either fur or clay to make it sort of a thatched or straw roof. But I'm thinking I'll rip the windowsills off so there are just holes, and maybe just put a bar in the middle like you'd see with some of the Dark Age stuff. It's just very basic. You don't have like really nice window frames. And I'll rip the chimneys off, maybe leave a hole, because they would have like a hole. I was thinking of even doing some of the grass turf tops like I did on my pitched house, because I still have some of that material, instead of hay. That was another option, with just a hole there. And I was just going to put like the coffee sticks all over the fronts and the sides to give it that sort of plank kind of look. So I'm thinking I might do that. Because I do want to use them for Saga, because I want to build more Saga terrain. I'm in a bit of a Saga mood at the moment, because I haven't played in a while, and I do like the game. I've got a game tomorrow, actually, like I was mentioning last week. I have a little bit of Saga painting that I got to do as well, but I don't know when I'll get to it. I have some heroes, some warlords that I've never tried, and I do... One of the things I noticed with my Danes is that, if I've won recently against Vikings, it's been by the skin of my teeth. I've had some really good games, but I found I've been using two big groups of levies in my two groups of 12 in my 6-point warband. And I found that there are ways to deal with range fire that the Vikings have. Like, there's an ability where they can essentially ignore like your round of fire, and you can do it. I almost think that, I'm trying to remember whether he can do it twice in a round or what, but he's been able to be pretty effective at avoiding my range stuff. And although I can use the levies with some of the special abilities, and using them almost as like delivery units of special abilities for the Danes, big groups don't really make a whole lot of sense for that, like groups of 12, to just deliver something that a group of 6 could. For those of you that don't play Saga, it has battle board abilities. And so I was almost thinking that I should be taking my box I got right here, my Dark Age Warriors, I have extra sprues, and just making up another group of 8 of Warriors, and take either one large group of levies or 2 small groups, and instead of 2 large groups, and utilize that other Saga die or point with another group of Warriors. Just to have some more flexibility in my list making. Right now I feel, because to do a 6-point warband right now, all I have is, the only way I can get to it is if I take 2 large group of levies with the models I've painted up. And it's just a little limiting. Having said that, in some circumstances, the levies have been very good. I played a game last fall, and it was against, we had 3 people, like myself and 2 others, that wanted to play, and so the way they decided to do this is that there'd be like 2 3-point armies against my 6-point army. We kind of just fudged it a bit, and I think because they had 2 warlords involved, they gave me a priest, you know, to use, a warrior priest or something like that, and it was fun. It was a good game. I think they came into the game not having played levies before, because we were all kind of fairly new players in the grand scheme of things. when you think about the amount of lists that we've developed or played against. And they kept trying to go into my levies. And I think I was using... There's an ability that the Danes have where you can basically force them to not do an action that they try. So, like, they can come at you and you can say, nope, you're not moving. And I think I did that a number of times, and then I think I just buffed their defenses. And I was just doing enough that they were really spending a lot of time with their... either their warriors or their hearthguard coming after my levies as a wall of levies, two of 12, that when I finally did get around to using my own hearthguard or warriors on them, it was pretty debilitating. You know, it could have been dice rolls and things too, but they walked away from it saying, oh my gosh, like I really underestimated the levies, and I just shouldn't have spent so much time trying to go through that wall of levies. Having said that, I've played games where the levies have just been walked right through as well, so I think it just really depends. I find Saga to be a very strategic game. I mean, it's not just combat dice rolls, but it's dice rolls of what abilities you get on the battle board, and I found the battle board to be so key, which is refreshing, because although some people might not like that style of game, it's the only game I have that's like that. And I can play a dozen different games that are just small skirmish games that have very similar mechanics and that are very tactical in their approach. But I don't have any games like Saga, other than Saga, that is very strategic in its use of the battle board. It's almost like a game on the side of the game that really dictates a lot. It's still a dice game, and we've had games where the dice have just been either amazing or... And what I mean by a dice game, I mean in combat. We've had games that are, you know, that have been either really good or bad for someone with dice. Really noticeably. As a matter of fact, the gentleman that I'm playing a game with tomorrow, I've definitely played more Saga with him than anybody, and when we first started playing, the dice were just the bane of his existence, and I was beating him, like, a lot, and he didn't really know how to use his battle board very well when first starting, and he's really figured that out. I mean, honestly, he's pretty good at using the Vikings battle board now against my Danes. We usually have nail-biter games most of the time. Although I did play one game with him where he just cleaned my clock, like, early on with the Vikings. I think it actually had to do with the scenario, too. It's been a while, but we played a scenario where it can end very quickly in certain circumstances if you follow the rules to a T. And that's what ended up happening. It said, like, if you had so many points... I think it was the one where if you get onto pieces of terrain, you get victory points, and if you get so many points, if you're this many points ahead of your opponent, at any point in the game ends. And yeah, like, it was the first time we played that one, and the game ended not in my favor very quickly. One thing that's good about these buildings for Saga is that they're closed buildings, but you don't really need... There isn't... Your units fight at the door. Like, there isn't, like, you know, you don't move in and tactically take over a building. It's more that somebody occupies a building and they have benefits because of that. And, you know, like, you don't actually have to have your miniatures in there. And so, in this case, that's actually quite good. So, the other thing I wanted to talk about is, as much as I'm not interested in picking up this game right now, at all, just because I don't want to pick up another game right now. I just noticed on my email and my news feeds and stuff that Warlord is releasing a game that's a samurai game, and they included a free PDF for it. So it's called Test of Honor, and it's a samurai skirmish game. It made me think of Ronin, just because there's Ronin that's already out there, and I've never played that. I always thought it looked very cool. Both the two people I think of that I just know through YouTube for those games is Tristan, because he did like an amazing, really entertaining Bat Rep Athlith for Ronin. And then also, I also think of Pete at Mini Warzone, just because I know he quite likes Ronin, and he had some nice stuff for Ronin. Miniature stuff painted up, and he's talked about Ronin quite a bit. It seems like it's been one of those Osprey games that people really like, and I noticed that the Osprey games are really popular. There's a lot of them, but I guess not surprisingly so, because there's different authors. Certain ones take off better than others. Now, I know Osprey puts out Bolt Action, and I almost think that Bolt Action, because of its being, you know, made by Warlord Games, it's almost a bit of a thing into itself. It's not really part of the Osprey small book series. It was just published by them, at least the version that I had, not the necessarily the second edition, but the original. I should talk about Bolt Action too, since I'm on the subject. But yeah, the some of the Osprey games are really quite good, and really, I enjoyed the games that I played of In Her Majesty's Name. Thought that was a very cool game. And I still have my crew, and I sometimes talk to my friends about playing it a bit, because it's just so forgiving with the number of miniatures that you need. And I like that little that steampunk genre. It's really a cool game. It actually had interesting mechanics too that were different than, like as far as combat and stuff, that were different than other things I've played. So I enjoyed that. But I can just see from listening to other people's channels and stuff that there are certain ones that people just quite like. I think it's Lion Rampant, Dragon Rampant, those ones that are actually quite popular as well. A lot of people really like Ronin. So there are a number of good ones. It's interesting because I don't find with the ones that I've tried with the Osprey that any one of the games, because of the size of the books, are meant to or extremely in-depth, just because of the number of pages and sheer number of... I think when you have just so much room, perhaps that is an approach, is to make a simple sort of skirmish game that is enjoyable, that reflects a period or a fantasy world, and yeah, you just enjoy it and you get what you want out of it. When I look at something like, I think it'd be really difficult to have a book like Sharp's Practice within the confines of an Osprey publication. Maybe I'm wrong with that. I mean, maybe, because really sometimes less is more. But in my mind, I sort of classify like small skirmish rule sets, quick skirmish rule sets, to be a little bit different than some of the other offerings that are a bit more involved, have a bit more robustness to the rules, maybe even a little bit of a longer game length, I'm not sure. The Bolt Action, I have had a bit of a desire to get back to my painting my World War II. I mean, just like I'm kind of enjoying this right now and getting back into fantasy, I have like a lot to paint for World War II. I never picked up the second edition of the rules. By all accounts, from everybody that I've heard talk about it, it's only been positive. I think I'll probably end up picking the second version up eventually. I was really interested in the platoon combat, like the tank platoon combat, and accidentally I picked up the PDF. I bought the PDF when I wanted the book of Tank War, and I have some tanks to paint. So I'll have to get to that at one point. It's an area that I get in sort of, I guess I get interested in every so often, and I come back to, but it doesn't like capture my interest all year round. I don't know if that makes sense. I just sort of have times where I just want to play some World War II, and then I have times where I like to set it down, and I just feel the horse and musket black powder period calling me, and I almost really never get tired of that. So that's kind of, I guess, where I'm at. I haven't really gotten tired of the saga yet either. The Dark Ages. I might do a battle report tomorrow. Although I'm a little wary because it's been a while, months since I've played, and I don't want to get something wrong for the report, but I think I can wing it. We've played it enough. I find the hardest, where I've gotten things wrong most often in Saga is in the movement, because you can only move so close before your men, and it's a good aspect of the game that your men just sort of go after the enemy, right? Like, you can't have, like, a group of Vikings under your command and send them within really close proximity and expect them not to want to fight them. And that's kind of what happens, you know, like, and so sometimes you try to get tactical in Saga when it is a fairly strategic game and you get your men too close thinking you can control them and be that guy, but really you're the warlord on the hill. You can't be that guy. That guy is who he is, and he's going to go after the people you get him close to. And so you have to keep him at least at a certain distance away if you want to be controlling them and not going after folks. It's an interesting aspect of the game and an area that both my friend and I that I play the game with have probably gotten wrong at times when just playing our home games here and stuff. Which, that's always the case. I'm not a tournament player, but we need to actually follow that rule because it is a good aspect of Saga, in my opinion, that you know, you're not meant to. And also, very similar to that, there's the Warrior's Pride, or the Warlord's Pride, I think is the name of the rule, where if you get your warlord within so close to another warlord, they have to go after each other. And I think we have fudged on one battle report. I think it was Ralph, who actually knows Saga really well, that pointed that out on a battle report. But it is a lot of fun. I'd like to do the campaign. I've heard good and not so great things about it, but a quick glance looking at it suits me, like, because I like Saga to try it. I like the idea of a campaign for it. One thing I did, I got really cerebral, I know, in my last chat. I don't always have something like that to talk about, so I'm not sure I'm going to be able to live up to that today for those of you that found it interesting. But I thought I would bring up another topic today. I should just put in the description, like, cerebral discussion starts at, because you know that this is going to be the rest of the video now, if I get talking on something like this. I was just telling my daughter yesterday, they were asking me about accents, and I was talking about, because my mom still has a very thick New York accent, and I left when I was 23, I think I was 23, and I still say certain words, I don't know if you guys catch it, but like as if I'm back in Long Island, and I think I just said talking, I started to go talking instead of talking, and I mentioned that, giving an example to my kids, and they were like, yeah, like grandma, right, like she still says that, coffee instead of coffee. I digress. But the topic that I wanted to talk about is Facebook a bit. And wargaming groups, Facebook groups, and the hobby, like, this is the YouTube component, you know, we're on YouTube. There's also the Facebook component. Now, I've had folks ask me, you know, what is your presence? You know, do you have, like, a channel presence on Facebook? And I don't. I don't actually do anything with Heresy Productions as a channel on Facebook. I also, you know, I don't know, someday, just, like, depending on the way things go, I may end up doing the advertisements just because at a certain point, they actually hinder your channel if you don't monetize. You're actually able to do less with your channel. They only offer certain things to use in the control and statistically and just various things with your channel. There are some benefits to just monetize, but I don't really need the monetization, like, you know, that's not what I'm doing this for, but if I do decide to do that, who knows? I have no plans at this point, but I don't link like my stuff with a Facebook and with like a blog or web page in order to maximize visibility. Because I just, yeah, like I'm not trying to do that necessarily. So I do look at stuff on Facebook and use my personal account, although, and my I don't use Facebook that much for family and friends. Like, I don't, I'm not, like, somebody that posts every day, like, what's going on Facebook. I think I have, I probably average about 3 or 4 a year posts. Like, I usually have, like, my kids on Halloween. I have a bit of a tradition where I always put them up on it. And I don't put anything with my hobby on it, to be honest. I think I may have had some of my fish tanks on Facebook at one point, just showing how my corals were. But, and so, where am I getting going with this? I do belong to a fair number of groups, Facebook groups, to look at stuff that's going on. And it's actually kind of addicting. And not in a good way for me, I think. It's a major time suck. What taught me that more than anything recently, and this is more of a problem with me than the Facebook group probably, but the whole Marvel thing, because I wasn't really, I was falling out in my interest in the rules, I when the game first came out, I was really talking and sharing quite a bit on the Marvel Facebook group, the closed group, you know, these groups. And in all fairness, when I started to lose interest in the game, I just sort of disappeared from it because I just lost interest. But around the same time that I kind of was gaining some interest again... Sorry, folks, my camera ran out of memory and then I had to, like, go back and find out exactly where it stopped. So as I was saying, right around the time that I kind of was getting interested in the Marvel stuff again, there was these rumors that actually it was going away. And, all of a sudden, you know, the drama associated with that, I was, in my mind, caught up into that, just like lots of people get caught up into, and disappointment around that, and just whatever. I don't really get overly excited on the internet, but when people logically try to support a position that I don't agree with, that I'm sort of interested in the subject, just like a lot of people, I can get interested in discussing it, and it becomes just sort of like a pointless mental exercise. It's a complete waste of time to, and I'm not even just talking about like this, the discussion piece on forums and on Facebook, but just at that point, I was just constantly checking on this, whether it be via my phone or my iPad, just looking at stuff. And I just find that sometimes too much information and too much of the social component of social media, it can be constructive, and it also can be just a big-time waste. So I ended up just, you know, I think it's kind of silly to say goodbye, too, but I just ended up, like, not saying goodbye, but just, like, to folks, but just completely just deleting my account there and just taking off. Because I just, yeah, didn't really want to... I actually enjoyed looking at people's painting and was still pretty constructive, giving feedback, like just giving support to folks that are painting stuff. But now that I'm not going to be playing the game anymore and it's not coming back, just moving on to other things. In some ways, I do hope that... a company like Fantasy Flight Games maybe picks up the license, because as much as they won't make beautiful pewter miniatures like Knight Models does, even just having plastic miniatures of the quality of Imperial Assault, that is the Marvel brand, would be of interest to me, just because I love Marvel so much. But yeah. I still belong to Facebook groups, and I even I left a number of them yesterday, I think, or the day before, just to really clean out my amount of information that's coming towards my feed and stuff, and just if I'm not looking at them, why even have them and things like that. But I actually joined one too. Like, I think they're a good thing, but they can be a huge time waster. One thing I am interested in, I guess just speaking of other things, is I am interested in painting some of my old hammer up this year, if possible. And I've been looking at, speaking of Osprey books, I believe it's Osprey that puts out Rogue Star. Now, it's a fairly small skirmish game. I mean, I think your number of models is something like 4 to 6. So it's nothing of the scale of my Rogue Trader stuff that I've purchased and bought into with different sides for my orcs and space elves. But it would be something that would be cool just to try it with. I have a friend that has the rules and is into it, interested in it, so it's a possibility. I've been thinking about airbrushing a bit again, and or just in general, just thinking about it, and whether it's time to actually upgrade my setup at all. It's still going strong. That's sort of what my hindrance is to put any more money into it, because it still works. I do feel like after years of using the same airbrush, that it's possible that, you know, you start to see a decrease in performance. I mean, you keep cleaning it and everything. Just your mechanisms and even the metal itself. Like, over time, I do find that it's possible that they wear out a bit. They just lose performance and wear out a bit and things. I don't know for sure. I mean, I think it's interesting because when you look at some of the packages they offer with airbrushes. Like, I have the Posh Talon. You can buy 5 at a time. Like, they have, like, packages where you can buy 5 at a time. And I think they're meant for, like, shops that do, like, airbrushing continuously. But what that sort of tells me is that I doubt that that is just 5 airbrushes for 5 guys for life. You know, I think that that's actually, in some ways, because you do want to get a replacement on occasion. I would buy another Posh Talon to replace my Posh Talon. I actually quite like my Posh Talon. I was also looking at, they have another one that's sort of a precision one. I don't know if it was Badger or Posh that I was looking at. I do know that I was looking at the Posh one that's a precision brush. So I was thinking about getting that. I'm also just thinking about my compressor too, because it's getting pretty long in the tooth. It still works. It heats up faster, and it's harder to build up to the higher pressure than it used to be. So it's just, it's like an old car. It's the way I view it. They don't last forever. And I've been using this since 2012. I feel like I've gotten my investment out of it at this point. But having said that, the thing about this hobby, I don't know about you guys, but sometimes I find it hard to invest in things other than the miniatures. Like, you always want to get, like, some miniatures or various things, but the ancillary things that you want to get to support the hobby are sometimes harder to justify because you want to get other things. And so, sometimes I actually think of things in miniatures. I don't know if that actually goes beyond, that shows, like, a real hobby addict, right, is when you want to buy something and you actually think in your head what that is in miniatures. I think as time goes on, I've actually started to value getting my stuff that supports the hobby more. Even just like my paint racks here to clean up my desk and make painting miniatures more enjoyable. But I still do that sometimes. Thinking of things in miniatures. Like you could talk about a game mat, which makes your gaming just so much better. But you might actually think about, like, well, if I get that game mat, then it means I can't get this new unit I want to get for my army or whatever. And you go through this, like, turmoil, right? Or wrestling that over in your head. In most situations, looking back, I think it's actually better to get the thing that helps the hobby and not the miniature. Because most of us have too many miniatures. But it is just sort of a constant addiction. We just like our miniature sculptures. So yeah, I may end up upgrading my set a bit. In some ways, I was thinking about getting the detail brush, but the practical side of me just tells me not to, because I don't really think I'll use it that much. I almost think I need to go just from one general use workhorse nice airbrush to the next when I use it up. Or when I just wear it out to the point where I need another one. Because I think the detail one is just going to sit on a shelf most of the time. And for what I need to do from a detail perspective, I can just probably just pull out my brush. That's not to say that other people shouldn't get those. I mean, like, there are people that like to do that kind of work with the airbrush. But I'm just thinking from, like, a practical perspective and spending my money. I might want to just replace what I've got. At this point, I could almost just be happy with just replacing it with exactly what I have. Which I guess is a good sign of a purchase if you... Like, in some ways I want to try something new, but in some ways with an airbrush I don't, because I've gotten used to all the little aspects of the feel of it, and it's such a tangible activity. Tangible in the sense of tactile is the word I'm looking for, not tangible. It's like a tactile kind of activity, because you're just like, you know in your head, your body and your brain subconsciously know when everything's working right, and you pull back on the lever how much paint is coming out to deliver what you want to do. And it's just through experience that you learn that. It's no chart or anything like that, or technical guide, you know, it's like a tactile function. So when you switch to another brush, it's going to change. And we can't have that. Can't have change. That's funny. I work in a job where we utilize a computer system like many people, and it's fairly integral to what we do. And we switched systems recently. And I've been through this before in various capacities with computer systems and other jobs and various things. And I always know that there's that resistance to change piece that always comes up. And in most cases, like historically, like the end product you have is usually meant to be better. You know, like this, usually what people think of going to, even at an, sort of executive level to switch to, has some sort of basis of benefit at a practical level. If they know what they're doing, they're also including people that are going to use it every day and, you know, making those decisions and things. And honestly, I think I've ended up in a stereotypical situation where even having used this system for, it'll soon be a month, but getting the ins and outs of it, it'll never be the same again as far as efficiency. Like, we've basically added layers upon layers of steps to a process that you really can't find efficiencies in other spots to eliminate. And so literally you're doing a lot more work to do the same thing that you did before. Now, the benefit in it is further documentation of that work. So from a legal perspective and, you know, from like a risk-averse perspective, it's better. But from, you know, it actually, there's a fairly short span of time before that work reaches a customer. This isn't like back-end work. This is like actually fairly front-end handling, you know, work to deal to provide an output to a customer. And the wait times have increased significantly. And are not probably going to change. And so it's a bit frustrating. So my discussion around change and how we can't have that, I say in jest, it's also true to some degree. Yeah, well, this video's gone on for a while, even though I had that little interruption there. I'm glad I didn't lose most of it, because I just looked up and my camera was just in the... I have a Sony, and it was just on the Sony screen, like, not showing the video. And I was surprised. I thought maybe I only got, like, a minute of it recorded, but it recorded most of it, most of the discussion today. I am pretty far along with my basis now. I'm expecting that today, tomorrow, I have to go into work this evening, so I'm expecting that I'll be done with the basis and then working back on the base paint. I'm probably going to do the loincloths on everyone, the eyes, the grips on the bows and the, they're not tassels, they're sort of like leather that binds the spear on for the spear, and then like sort of the banners. I have all that to do on all of them. It's funny because if I was dealing with, like, 10 guys, you know, it would be really fast, like, to do all of that. When you're dealing with 60, every little thing that you do would just, yeah, it just takes so long. But I am really liking having, like, that first layer of base paint. Now, because I'm using the plaster, I can see little spots where the paint didn't get into, but it'll, in further working on the base and various things, that'll all get covered up, and I'm not worried about that, so. All right. Pretty long chat, but some people seem to like this. I guess the last piece of discussion I'll end with is, you know, it's funny because I had the Q&A series, and although some of my friends that I consider friends and some folks that were interested in the Q&As, I get the questions here and there and stuff, based on, like, the short amount of responses and the views and things of just my chat, my Heresy Hump Day chat, it seems to be more popular than the Q&A. I don't know why that is, because I feel like, for me, it's almost I'm doing the same thing. It's just instead of responding to someone's question that they actually have a question for, it's actually just me just spouting off, like, for an hour or whatever. I do like these. I've been watching other people's, because when I paint, just like the Q&As, when I paint, I find that it's really cool to just chill out, like, and listen to somebody else's thoughts on things while they're doing the same thing. I just find that fun. So it passes the time real well. So I hope that you guys like this too. I don't know how often I'll do this at this point. For me, Heresy Hump Day as a is a time slot that I try to adhere to, and it will, if I put it up, it's going to range from Tuesday night to Thursday morning, my time, putting it in. But it's kind of around that hump part of the week. Just to get me to constantly put something up in the beginning of the week. I usually put something up on, you know, Thursday, Friday, or Saturday, or Sunday. You know, I usually put something up, but I'm trying to push it a little earlier. And so that's the purpose of this. So yeah, thanks for stopping by, and talk to you later.